Okay, so I think everybody here is aware that we're way behind schedule, and Dominique has to leave for the airport at no later than 5, so that's, we can't possibly go any later than that. We're supposed to stop at 4:15, so shall we shoot for stopping at 4:45? Does that make sense? And then there's going to be some kind of final session, right, which is not in this program.
This is the final session.
Well, I thought, oh, see, the draft that I saw had a little thing glued on at the end.
Oh.
Okay. All right, so without any further ado, let's, I'm Tim Colton from this university, and I'm very proud to be a member of the executive committee at the Harvard Ukrainian Institute. And I was asked to chair this panel on New Frontiers, so looking forward. And we have four excellent panelists. I've not discussed at least the order in which they ought to go, and therefore, unless I'm informed otherwise, we'll go in the order in which the names are listed, which is alphabetical. So we would start with Dominique Arel from the University of Ottawa, who heads a very vigorous and successful and innovative program at the University of Ottawa in Ukrainian Studies. He's a political scientist who's worked on a variety of topics. Volodymyr from UCal Riverside, another political scientist who's going to talk about new frontiers in the study of Ukrainian politics. Dominique is going to address doctoral research on Ukraine. Paul was a very senior administrator at several universities for a number of years, but fortunately for us, he decided to get out of all of that and come back to teaching and research, so that's great for the field. Volodymyr Kulyk, to my left, is a Ukrainian scholar from the Academy of Sciences in Kiev. He is best known, I think, both at home and here, for his work on language in Ukraine over many years, but he also has addressed a number of other important politics. And finally, Oxana Shevel from Tufts University, Ukrainian-born, now U.S.-based, a political scientist who got a PhD here, and who has worked mostly on political institutions and the politics of rights. She's going to talk about nation building in post-Soviet Ukraine. So let's start with Dominique.
All right.
Sir. You can do it standing up or sitting down, whatever suits you, but if you have slides, it's probably better standing up.
Yeah, I'm not sure what to do now with the slides.
Where's the slide? Do we have a person there?
Okay. Yeah.
Please point.
Especially since I'm not a... Okay. Oh, it's already up. Okay. And then change the slides. Ah, like this. Got it. All good. All right. Okay. So, the future is now the state of doctoral research on contemporary Ukraine. Let me time myself here.
Switch it from Canadian time to
depends which Canadian time, right? Since 2005, the chair of Ukrainian studies at the University of Ottawa in Canada has had the privilege of hosting an annual international research conference on contemporary Ukraine called the Danilyu Seminar, named after a foundation in Toronto. The seminar includes a number of doctoral students. As we are taking stock of the state of Ukrainian studies at this conference, I thought that I could rely on the participation of these doctoral students at the Danilyu seminar to assess trends that may not be apparent to most of us. The first caveat is that the chair in Ottawa is in the social sciences. I am attached to a political science department, and so are my students, except one who is in sociology. Yuri, KIUS, the Canadian Institute of Ukrainian Studies, and other programs at the University of Alberta, as well as the Toronto chair, have built their reputations in the humanities, and we saw our mission in Ottawa to focus on social science research. We thought initially that this would exclude history, but it took us only 2 years, by 2007, to realize how mistaken that was. with historical memory being thrown at the center of post-Orange Revolution Ukrainian politics. We quickly realized that the study of contemporary Ukraine had to include contemporary history, which in practice meant the study of 20th century Ukraine. In other words, the cohort of doctoral students that we are examining in this presentation are from the social sciences and the history of the past century, not literature, linguistics, folklore, or pre-20th century history, generally understood as the humanities. Between 2005 and 2017, 196 people were on the program of the Danilu seminar, an average of 15 new participants every year, which in itself is a sign of the vitality of the field. Several made repeat visits over this time span, but they are counted only once. Of this number, 58 were doctoral students at the time of their visit, if they came back later. Some graduate students came back, they were no longer graduate students. On average, thus, between 4 and 5 doctoral students present their research at the seminar every year. The database I'll be using for my remarks is thus based on 58 doctoral students over a period of 13 years. I actually could have used a larger database, since I have also been in charge of the academic program of the ASN Convention, as in Association for Studies of Nationalities, for the past 2 decades at Columbia University, with a large Ukraine section. Just this past weekend in New York, we had 24 panels or events on Ukraine. An ASN database would probably yield 3 to 4 times as many doctoral students working on Ukraine, and I could certainly build one in the near future. Different project. Yet, there are definite advantages in relying on a Danilu seminar database. The first is funding. The seminar covers all expenses to participants that are selected, which is not the case for a large convention like ASN. This makes quite a difference for graduate students, especially those from Ukraine. It is rare that Ukraine-based students can get funding on their own. The Danilu seminar has the means to identify very good students from Ukraine and bring them over, enabling us to draw inferences on graduate student research in Ukraine. The second advantage is that a seminar, by definition, is much more selective than a convention, as there are far fewer slots available. Overall, only between 15 to 20% of applicants are accepted by the seminar. What this means is that those making it are cumulatively the strongest, or so we think, with, in principle, greater opportunities of remaining active in academia, and in Ukrainian studies in particular, after their doctoral studies. I could add that a cohort of 58 doctoral students is large enough to make some general observations. The first observation concerns gender. 40 of the 58 doctoral students are women, a proportion of 68%, a complete reversal of the older generation represented on panels at this conference. From the beginning, I could always see with my own eyes how the field has changed since the mid to late 1990s. Among all Danilu participants, nearly 200, as I indicated earlier, the proportion of women is actually at 55%. But I never realized until I computed the data that it was so high among doctoral students. Upon closer inspection, however, we can detect a definite ethnic factor, or more broadly, in Magoshian terms, ethno-territorial. As we all know, Ukrainian studies in North America, or before the war in Germany and Czechoslovakia, I said before the war, but it's, I mean in the interwar period. Yeah, was a creation, so Ukrainian studies in North America was a creation of the Ukrainian diaspora. We learned yesterday of the extraordinary fundraising effort in all corners of the Ukrainian-American diaspora to make the creation of URI possible, and the endowed chairs here. Understandably, the first generation of Ukrainian studies scholars were almost entirely from the diaspora, with a few notable exceptions. The demography of the field began to change dramatically in the 1990s after Ukraine became independent. And an increasing number of non-ethnic Ukrainians, or people whose relatives did not hail from the territory of Ukraine, became interested in the study of problems that could be investigated in Ukraine. In our Danilu doctoral database, a slight majority, 53%, or 31 of 58, do not have a Ukraine connection. It's actually the rest here, I didn't put it up. Roughly speaking, we can say that the field is now half connected to Ukraine by biography and half not connected, which is probably the sociologically normal equilibrium for an area study. In other words, the field has become legitimized in terms of mainstream academia. It has a lot to do with statehood, but also with the fact that when everything is said and done, Ukraine is and remains an open society, which allows for a great variety of scholarly research. Unlike Russia, there is an actual civil and political society to investigate in Ukraine. The other half, the one that I put up here, those doctoral students with a personal connection to Ukraine can be divided in three different types. The first is the Ukrainian diaspora, which is by far the least numerous, with only two of our 27 students. The field used to be, as I said, dominated by the diaspora, with either first-generation scholars born in Europe or second-generation born abroad of parents born in Europe. But there are very few third-generation doctoral students. They have been replaced by students either from Ukraine or born in Ukraine but residing abroad at the time of the Danilu seminar in which they participated in. We had 10 Ukraine-based and 15 Ukraine-born students at the seminar. I should add that a few of these Ukraine-born students were in fact borderline diaspora, since they came with their parents as teenagers before they embarked on graduate studies. A stunning statistic, if I can go back here, is that 84% of these Ukraine-based or Ukraine-born doctoral students are women, all but four in a group of 25. 27, actually, sorry. This in itself explains why more than two-thirds of our Danilu doctoral students are women. As I mentioned earlier, the gender breakdown of the entire seminar over 13 years is 55-45, 55% favoring women. The same proportion applies to doctoral students without a personal connection to Ukraine. Those with a direct Ukrainian connection, however, are overwhelmingly women, and the question is why? I can only hypothesize that socioeconomic conditions in Ukraine have an asymmetrical effect on gender, with young Ukrainian men disproportionately not opting for an academic path, either in Ukraine or abroad. The discipline breakdown is also surprising. Where is the discipline breakdown? Jeez, I didn't put it up. Sorry. Discipline breakdown is so surprising that I'll keep it as a surprise. All but three students were from four disciplines: political science, sociology, anthropology, and history. The surprise, certainly to me, is that only 22%, so 13 of my 58 students, were in political science. 13. Yet the chair is based in the political science department. Four of our the five scholars on the selection committee are political scientists, and so were two of three others who were evaluating in earlier seminars. A plurality of our doctoral students were historians, 20 of them, with 13 sociologists and 9 anthropologists. So what account for this relative devalorization of their own discipline by seminar evaluators? The first point is that it is not a self-conscious effort. As with the gender breakdown, it's only now that I realize that the proportion is so low. Doctoral students are on average 1/3, sometimes less, of the overall participants in any given seminar, which is why these trends may not be so obvious even to us. More substantively, what makes proposals stand out is a promising theoretical argument with a solid empirical base. It is the latter criteria, very often, that appear to have given a comparative advantage to historians and sociologists. Put differently, political science applicants are not as strong as they should be on fieldwork. A caveat is that the boundary between political science and sociology is porous, particularly in Europe. Two of our French colleagues on the selection committee actually call themselves political sociologists, which is prevalent in Europe. The European factor is significant, not one I put up, it's right here. If we include those based in Ukraine, a touch over half of our doctoral students are from Europe. If we exclude them, a little more than a third are European, 40% of whom are Ukraine born. This points to a clear shift from the previous generation. Ukrainian studies outside of Ukraine is no longer predominantly North American. Expectedly, the UK, Germany, and France are doing well. The outlier remains Russia. Prior to Maidan, we never had a single proposal from a Russia-based doctoral student that we considered strong enough for an invitation. In fact, we receive comparatively few of these proposals. The remark by Sherman Garnett 20 years ago that no one in Russia is seriously studying contemporary Ukraine remained true well before the tension between the two states reached a breaking point. We had our first student in 2015. We would have had two more in 16 and 17, but they could not get a visa, either at all or on time. These three candidates were affiliated with the European University in St. Petersburg, whose existence is now under threat in Russia, if it still exists. I don't know about the latest news. How well are these students faring on the job market? 15 of them, do I have that up? Yes. 15 of them, or about a quarter, have found tenure track appointments in universities. An additional 5 are affiliated with research institutes, all in Europe. But I do not have additional information to establish the degree of job security that these appointments bring. While these numbers may appear to be on the low side, I must point out that we are dealing with a moving target. A dozen of our doctoral students are still doctoral students, because they came in the last several years. 6 more have postdoctoral fellowships, and 4 have teaching contracts that may or may not lead to a more permanent situation. We could plausibly get to a point where half of the cohort, perhaps a little more, have secure appointments. 3 more have institute or program staff positions that keep them connected to academia. Overall, only 13 of our cohort, or 22%, are either no longer in academia or could not be accounted for. In closing, a few observations on the research agenda. Nearly 30% of our students work on topics related to civil society, with a core on protest, whether it's Orange Revolution protests, now Maidan protests. This reflects the strong presence of sociologists and anthropologists in the pool. The flip side is that only a couple work on regime politics, democracy, authoritarianism, the kind of research that Luke and Wei and Serhii Kudelia have been leading. Actually, Kudelia is in the pool, so he's kind of the exception to the rule. And only two touch on the rule of law. In other words, our students shy away from the state and are attracted to non-state actors. Access to respondents and data may be a factor at play. 14, or almost a quarter, work on World War II, often with an additional focus on how war events are interpreted in memory narratives. They touch on all the difficult questions, the Holocaust, the police, the Divizia, the Polish-Ukrainian War, and the deportation of civilians. 70% of our history doctoral students work on World War II. I could add that literally all of them present a rather critical research, critical to the dominant narrative. Half of them are Ukraine-born. So there's a very interesting international collaborative effort on that sensitive front. Three final remarks. First, the study of the Holodomor at the graduate level is only beginning. We've had two candidates. I put four here because two more were tangentially working on the Holodomor, but two frontally. And there appears to be at least three more in the emerging cohort. So what Paul said earlier may or may not be true. And the debates were passionate. But it's not reflected, actually, at the graduate level. That kind of research is actually beginning, would be my observation. Second, the study of gender is on the rise. I can see that among my own students at the chair. And third, the most glaring absence is that of security studies. The proposals are not lacking, but we haven't had a single paper over the years at the graduate level. This could be a bias on our part, as the political scientists in our group are all in comparative politics and not in international relations. The persistent issues are methodological, either too descriptive, such as following the so-called conditionality process in the EU, or lacking originality, as in discourse analysis of dominant tropes, Russian narrative, Western narratives, etc., or normative, oriented more towards policy than theory-based research. Running the yearly Danilou seminar is an exercise in discovery, discovering the rising generation. And I have to say, the findings have been most encouraging. Thank you.
Thanks, Dominique. Thank all of you, and thanks to Hurry for inviting me. My computer, that's back. So what I'm going to talk about, I think, will mesh well with what Dominique's been talking about. He's been talking a lot about who's been doing research, and a little bit about what the research is about, and I'm going to sort of flip that priority. Where I really want to focus on is where I think research on Ukrainian politics is headed. But I do want to say a little bit about the past before I talk about the future. And what I want to say about the past is that for the post-Soviet era, since 1991 that is, in addition to there being a lot of very good research on Ukraine, focused on Ukraine, and more or less only focused on Ukraine, Ukraine has also been a big part of, if not at the center of, many of the most important discussions in political science, especially in the subfield that we call comparative politics. And for time reasons, I'll just point to five areas in which that's true. Excuse me. One is about identity politics. Right? We've got representatives all around us of these things. The intersection in Ukraine of, or overlapping of nation, ethnicity, language, region, and religion has made it an ideal place to study the interaction among those different markers as determinants of political attitudes and voting behavior. And actually, all the panel members except me have done really important work in that field. But it's a much bigger field, right? And some of the leaders in the broader political science field of identity politics have come to Ukraine in one way or another to ask the questions that they ask. And in fact, last week at ASN, there was just an overview of David Layton's book from 20 years ago, which had an important chapter on Ukraine, on which Dominique did most of the work. A second big field, which Dominique mentioned, is democracy and democratization. There are enormous literatures on democracy and democracy promotion, and Ukraine has been an important area to study that, because unlike the countries to its west, most of the countries to its west, it did not move fairly straightforwardly towards democracy until a few years ago. And unlike those to the east, it did not move somewhat straightforwardly toward autocracy. Instead, because it's been in between, and it could go either way, and has lurched back and forth, there's a lot to study there. And some of the people who have done important work that's very Ukraine-focused in that respect have been Lucan Way and Henry Hale, but lots of others have been involved. A third area related to democratization would be that of revolution, protest and revolution. The field the phenomenon that Mark Beisinger called modular revolutions, that many of us just call colored revolutions. Those revolutions, at least for a while and perhaps going forward, seem to be an important mechanism of democratization, or at least of slowing down or obstructing autocratization, which may not be a word, but I'm using it. And again, Ukraine is not the only case, but it's been one of the defining cases and one of the most widely studied cases. And again, some people on the panel have worked on that. Olya Onich is sitting up there. She's done comparative work on this case. And so Ukraine has then again brought in a lot of people more broadly from the field and been part of a big contribution. I might also point toward memory politics, which Dominique mentioned, which Oxana Shevel has worked on. Informal politics and sham institutions, which is a big field, a growing field of study across the world that Jessica Pisano has worked on. So across many of the biggest questions in political science, Ukraine's been a great place to do work. And I think that's actually been really great for the study of Ukraine more broadly, because it's had a lot of influential people paying attention. And it's, for those of us who really are focused on Ukraine, it's just made it that much more interesting to do the work. As Dominique mentioned, he's trying to steal all my thunder, much less true on the literature of international politics. There's been a lot written about Ukraine and Russia, Ukraine and the EU, but it has not been a literature that's been either really informed by or making a contribution to the broader literature on international politics. Rawi Abdullal, who's here at Harvard, wrote about national identity and integration policy, a really theoretically interesting book on that topic. Margarita Balmaceda, who was here yesterday, has written about energy politics. I've written about the tension, the economic interdependence between Ukraine and Russia, and about denuclearization. But the broader field of international politics didn't really take much notice of Ukraine, with a few very sporadic exceptions. Even when it did something quite remarkable, of course, which was become one of the very few countries in history to surrender its nuclear weapons. So that's the past, really at the center of the game in comparative politics, not so much in international relations. Let me talk now about the future. And of course, it's hard to know where politics in Ukraine is headed, but I think we will continue to see a situation in which Ukraine is a place that a lot of people go to study the big questions in comparative politics. The difference is, it's not good news for Ukraine, of course, but since 2014, a lot more people and from the broader field of international politics are now starting to come to Ukraine and look at Ukraine and what's going on there as well. So let me start there with the international politics. Scholars of international conflict in particular have been very eager to understand why the conflict happened, and in some cases, who is to blame. This includes both some scholars who know a great deal about international relations theory, but very little about the region, such as John Mearsheimer, and those who know a great deal about Russia, but relatively little about Ukraine, or about the broader literature on international conflict, such as Richard Sokka and Stephen Cohen. Sorry to name names, but there is better work. And I would point to Tim Colton's book with Sam Cherup, which brings together actually a very deep knowledge of the region with a much more thoughtful conceptual approach about why the conflict has happened and what might be done about it. But a arising out of that conflict, there's now a lot more research being done on international politics that you sort of have to go to Ukraine if you really want to do it. And I would just point to a few of those themes. One is hybrid warfare. What is it? How novel is it? How can it be combated? Is this the wave of the future? Or is what Russia has been doing in Ukraine since 2014, and frankly, for a long time before that, is that a one-off? The Cold War. We keep on hearing this discussion, is this a new Cold War? Well, when we move from talking about the Cold War to a Cold War, right, the Cold War is no longer a unique historical episode, it's now a category or a concept. And so I think we're gonna have to decide what we mean by a Cold War, what conceptually is a Cold War, and we'll have to figure out conceptually whether turning that from a historical case into a concept, whether that gives us any kind of useful leverage on what it is that we're trying to understand. In addition to maybe helping us think about, you know, it's not clear yet, I think, whether that concept reveals more than it obscures about the current situation, but to the extent it forces us to go back and rethink the first Cold War, that will probably be valuable. Russia's challenge to the post-Cold War system has raised the question of what kind of order, if any kind of order, is going to predominate in the coming years. This has been a favorite theme in Russian scholarship and commentary in recent years, and while much of that research more or less simply follows the line of the Putin regime, some of it is actually quite interesting. Two essential questions get to the material and normative conditions that will characterize the world in the coming decades. And the first question concerns the polarity of the emerging system. Russian thinking tends to blur hopes and facts on this, but essentially asserting both that the world is multipolar and is increasingly multipolar, and that it should be multipolar. Western scholars haven't talked much about this question of polarity in about 30 years, but I think if we want to understand Russian thinking about the current situation in the world, we probably should think harder about it. I think their conversation is worth taking seriously, at least in terms of revealing how Russia's looking at the world. And then the second question is about sources of legitimacy in the international system. And perhaps a slightly oversimplistic way of putting this is that the big question here is about the relative weight of, on the one hand, of a couple of 19th century ideas and norms, non-interference and spheres of influence, relative to late 20th century norms, such as democracy and human rights, and the idea that democracy and human rights, the 20th century ideas, trump those 19th century ideas. Obviously, much of the conflict in Ukraine, between Russia and Ukraine, involves a tension between those two normative commitments. Ukraine has had the very bad luck to be the battleground over which those debates are being fought, but I think that normative debate is one we need to understand better. And I would say again, I think the best work on that being done right now, or much of the best work, is being done by scholars that are in Russia and Ukraine. Then there's, of course, the crucial pragmatic question about how to address the conflict itself. And there are a couple of real puzzles here. And I'll probably show some bias here, but the most obvious puzzle to me is that while it's pretty clear that Russia is in the wrong, legally I think it's quite clearly in the wrong, it cannot be compelled to surrender the territory that it has seized. So there's a huge clash between what is right and what is possible. A larger issue, as I already mentioned, is this one of competing visions and competing interests of Russia and the West. And there's, of course, then the closer to home issue for Ukraine of this of the question of just a basic territorial conflict between Ukraine and Russia and how that would be addressed. So there is a lot of literature going back many decades, both theoretical literature and case-based, on conflict resolution. None of it is going to offer a simple solution to this conflict, but I think we're going to see more and more work trying to bring concepts more broadly from political science to this particular case, and therefore bringing in scholars who more generally consider them scholars of conflict and conflict resolution. How am I doing on time?
You've got about 5 minutes left.
Perfect. So in contrast to the pre-2014 era, Ukraine has now become very important, I think, to the study of international politics. It's going to continue being important to the study of comparative politics. And let me just point to a couple of fields. One is, again, this word that I've made up, autocratization. And I like it just because it's the flip side of democratization. And I always felt there was a huge bias in the literature on the one towards the other, because it seems like both are going on in different times and in different places. There's a lot on this now, frankly, especially considering what's going on in parts of Western Europe and what's going on in this country. So a couple of Harvard scholars, Levitsky and Ziblatt, have published basically a best-selling book on the topic. Sherry Berman has coined this term, I think she coined the term, democratic backsliding. Ukraine is a great place to study the process because it's had its fair share of democratic backsliding. And you've really, in Ukraine, going all the way back to the Kuchma era, you can sort of see the anatomy of how it gets done. At the same time, Ukraine is a good place to show why it fails. And Ukraine, frankly, has been a testing ground for the kind of stuff we see in other places. So it's a sort of canary in the coal mine, and I often point out to my American friends that those of us who study Ukraine knew the name Paul Manafort about 15 years ago, for better or worse. It's truly remarkable, especially in the light of Levitsky and Ziblatt's very widely read book, that a country with a very short history of democracy, none of the institutions and few of the norms that Levitsky and Ziblatt argue are essential to block or to protect from autocracy, and on top of that, an opposition that is generally fragmented and feckless, has somehow managed to maintain pluralism, or the pluralism by default, to use Lucan Way's term, that seems to be the next best thing to genuine democracy, which I don't think we can really claim Ukraine has. So there's a lot more work to be done on this, because if the leading treatment in the field says you need these two things to protect yourself from autocracy, and Ukraine doesn't really have either of them, and yet twice now in 10 years has resisted pretty concerted assaults from within with assistance from without on its democracy, how has that happened? We don't exactly know. Part of the answer to that might be something that Dominique mentioned as well, or that I mentioned above anyhow, which is informal politics. A lot of institutions are not necessarily strong in Ukraine, but informal institutions sometimes are very, very strong, sometimes much to the chagrin of reformers. But there's a lot more work being done on informal politics, including on an area that Dominique did mention, which is civil society. The work on civil society, going all the way back to de Tocqueville and certainly the famous work of Almond and Burba, is looking at formal civil society organizations, clubs, right? Bowling leagues in Bob Putnam's famous term. In Ukraine, research now is showing that, as in many other things, it's the informal networks where the action is at. And I think this is a place where Ukraine has people working on Ukraine might upend a lot of the contemporary research on civil society. There's a woman who's just finished a PhD at University of San Diego named Svetlana Krasinska, who's done a sort of ethnographic study of these organizations and why they very deliberately reject formal organization and what that means. All right, I'm gonna talk a little bit faster now so I don't overstay my welcome. The big puzzle, I think, this is my opinion, about Ukraine right now, and it's about its resilience, is about how Ukraine has maintained order even when the state has been on the verge of collapse. Everything we know in political theory says, without state authority, you get chaos. Anyone who was in Kiev in late 2013 or early 2014 knew that you could walk 2 minutes away from where the Maidan was going on, and people were buying their groceries and going to the bank and living life normally. Even when state order broke down, until the Russians invaded, Ukraine maintained perfect order. How can that be? There's a lot, some work being done on this. There's a good collection by Ed Schatz, who I think also has a Harvard connection, right? He was at the Data Center, and John Heathershaw on this. And then there's another line of research that Steve Hansen has done some work on, although I don't think it's published yet, basically looking at this notion of the Weberian state. And to make a long story short, Ukraine doesn't have control of its territory, it doesn't really have a monopoly on violence, and it doesn't have certainly a monopoly on legitimate use of violence, right? When Yanukovych's police, or when the Ukrainian police attacked people on the street, that was considered illegitimate. So when all three of the basic parts of the Weberian definition of the state, Ukraine doesn't really stack up. And yet, it works, it functions. The literacy is higher than it is here, and the crime rate is lower. So I think Ukraine has a Weber problem, so to speak. But I think Weber also has a Ukraine problem. We've invested an immense amount in political science and in social science generally about the this Weberian definition of the state, and it's not, I think it's time to interrogate that, as some people are doing. And the last thing I'll point to is this argument that's made by Yuri Andruhovich in Ukraine and by Alex Modell in this country, that Ukraine should willingly jettison the Donbass in Crimea because it would be a stronger state without it. This too, of course, calls into question this notion that a state has a fixed territory. And I've looked into this quite a bit, and as it turns out, there's almost no literature out there in any discipline on when and why states give up territory. And the reason is because states almost never voluntarily give up territory. But the question of, and this then of course gets to what Russia thinks it's being asked to do, which is to voluntarily give up its territory because it thinks Ukraine, or certainly at least Crimea, is Russian territory. So this question of, well, I should just say, in Lustig's work, which is the one person who's really looked at this, his argument is that you can't give up territory until you stop thinking of it as part of your state and you start thinking of it as a colony. And so but there's really not much comparative work on how that happens, when that happens, and why that happens. And I think Ukraine is going to be a place where, if this debate, Yanukovych's argument about ditching the Donbass, if that begins to brew, that's going to be another place that's going to draw in a lot of scholars interested in a lot of broader conflicts. So let me end there, echoing Dominique's point, though. The biggest change, and I think one of the best changes, is who's doing the work and where. Two big shifts are underway that I see clearly. One is from North America to a much broader distribution, including Western Europe and Ukraine. And the other is that half the population that was disincluded for a long time, that is the women, are now in the field and are coming into the field. And so to Simon Franklin's point earlier that the name of the game is getting talent into the discipline, the amount of talent flowing into political science, but social science more broadly on Ukraine, is really impressive. And so I'm actually very optimistic.
Yours?
No.
Okay.
But yours.
So we'll leave them here.
Sorry, I forgot.
Sorry.
I thought it would be here. No. Oh,
is
here?
Right?
No. The imaging.
I get it.
Here. Uh-huh. Okay. And then
just unmute it. Yeah, I'm gonna try.
Okay, thanks so much. It's great to be here again. Last time I spoke here was one of many times I spoke here about language, which Tim already mentioned is kind of perceived as my specialty. So much so that yesterday I was placed at a literary scholar's table because I'm doing languages. The only language Ukraine has is literature. That's everybody knows. Yeah. So this time around, I decided to avoid overstaying my welcome too much. Speak about something else, except that I didn't know that identity politics, of which I'm to speak, has become so mainstream that Paul would include it in his survey of what Ukrainian studies has become with regard to political science. I will focus obviously not on all identities, but on ethno-linguistic and ethno-national identities, of which I personally have done most of what I've been doing, and I believe most of research on any identities in Ukraine has focused on these kind of identities, which doesn't mean that there is no research on gender identities or political identities or territorial identities, but that's one kind of legacy of old, so to say, Ukrainian studies, that Ukrainian identities are perceived first and foremost as having to do with ethnicity and language, even though that's now in the process of change, as the very notion of what Ukrainian ethno-national identities are. These research basically started more or less at the same time as Ukrainian independence started. 25 years, half of Ukrainian studies at Harvard, of these 50 years we are here to celebrate. And the progress, the change, let's not speak of linear progress, the change is remarkable. We started from more or less essentialist perception of Ukrainian identities having to as having to do primarily with nationality, nationalities, yeah, Soviet concept, which was used for a long time as taken at face value. So that's one indication of how it was perceived. The question used in many surveys and modeled at the question in censuses was, what is your nationality? Rather than what do you perceive or who do you consider yourself to be? Yeah, there is such thing as nationality, and you just state it. Yeah, you just reveal it to the state in censuses and to survey takers in surveys. I use data from Institute of Sociology, National Academy of Sciences annual surveys, but to kind of extinguish annual fluctuations, which reflects primarily survey error, I grouped it in 5 years. Yeah, so to see more or less larger tendencies than fluctuations. And we see that this identity, Ukrainian, Russian, other, and no answer, just a little bit, in surveys unless in censuses, it gradually shifted from a Soviet picture of nearly a quarter of population being, or let's say, considering themselves Russians, yeah, toward just half of that later, and then even less in the later years, which are beyond this table, I mean, after the Maidan and the outbreak of war. So gradual change was perceived as kind of a legitimate shift, especially first we have a state which is supposed to be kind of nationalizing, if not exactly forcing, then encouraging the citizens to identify with the majority group, with the dominant nationality. And second, there was this perception that under the Soviets, many Ukrainians assimilated or re-identify themselves as Russians. So now they are coming back. Yeah. So for a long time, it was perceived as nothing special. Even when this census, which I indicate in the middle, 2001 census, the only one we have had so far, as compared with, in parenthesis, with last Soviet census on 1989, revealed that a quarter of Russians have miraculously disappeared somewhere. And there were titles like that. I analyzed media discourse on census. Четверть россиян кудись поділись. A quarter of Russians have disappeared somewhere. It wasn't really an alarm. You know, okay, bizarre things happen, yeah? So a quarter of Russians have disappeared, but basically, few people believe they moved out to Russia or to the Mars, yeah? Few people believe they died out. So basically, they somehow became Ukrainian, even though nobody actually believed it was something unique or bizarre or troublesome. Yeah. So the very concept of nationalism and what it stands for was not challenged in popular discourse or even in academic discourse. Yeah. It is still the same ethnicity, which is changing and which can produce such bizarre results. And not to worry. Yeah. In contrast, this was less troublesome, all the more so because Russians failed to live up to predictions by some scholars in the early 90s that they would make trouble in Ukraine, that they would be dissatisfied with perceived nationalizing intent and practices of the state, and they will rebel. Yeah, on the to paraphrase Alexander Motyl's title, "Will the Russians rebel?" Yeah, in Ukraine, many people believe they will, and even David Layton's book Identity Information perceived that they will not put up with nationalizing intent. They will distinguish themselves into a particular group defined by language, and they will not tolerate these nationalizing practices, and let alone assimilate. Yeah. So then they were starting gradually disappearing, but still there was no alarm. There was no particular attention to why this might happen for a long time. The contrast, in contrast, there was a focus for a while, and another category which was kind of problematized early on, native language. Already in the 90s, there was a survey question: how do you define your native language? I don't have a full set of alternatives, so I will not show you any table. But already in 1995, an article was published revealing that people primarily define nationality as language, native language as language of their thinking, or language of their nationality, like repeating, replicating the nationality, and some of language of their practice. And then in 15 years, another question like that, and still. More or less the same. Instead, language of practice gave way to language of parents, which is kind of counter to what we observed in Ukraine, because if people reclassified anything, they did not simply replicate the practices, the choices of their parents. But the interesting thing, which was not revealed until later, was that when doing something on their own, people tended to believe that they did not do something on their own, that they just replicated what their parents have. Their choice was kind of, not exactly mystified, but misperceived as inheritance. Yeah. So nevertheless, this choice, this change in native language allowed to problematize this as a category reflecting language practice. Something which already, which had already taken place in some Western studies of Soviet nationalities politics, based on Soviet censuses, which showed that the scale of Russification of Soviet society is much larger than the data on native language showed, and maybe native language is not exactly the degree of assimilation. Maybe it's something else, and maybe it's kind of ethnic pride or ethnic assertion or something relating consciousness rather than actual practice. Yeah, that's why. A new concept was called for, and then Dominique Arel and Valerie Chmielko suggested an alternative concept of measuring language processes and identities in Ukrainian society. They invented this concept of preferred language or language inconvenience, a language supposedly given off rather than consciously given by a respondent in an interaction with a supposedly fully bilingual and fully accommodated interpreter. There is no such thing, of course, but they didn't tell us that. And that there is interaction, so there is some social pressure, bigger or smaller, but there is pressure. There is perception of what is appropriate in a given interaction, and people live according to that interaction and not just reveal their inner self. But nevertheless, this idea that language of everyday preference is very much different from language declared to be native and from nationality, which was still perceived as purely ethnicity, pure marker of ethnicity, it gave way to a new division of Ukrainian society. Instead of just Ukrainian and Russian, different division according to preferred language, and we see that instead of a huge majority, an increasing majority of Ukrainians, you have a slight majority of Russian speakers. In again, grouped by 4 years, it doesn't go away linearly. Yeah, it goes back and forth. Still, in the early 2000s, it was a bit more than it was more than a half of people preferring Russian. Yeah. If you look by nationality, you see nationalists. You see that a huge majority of ethnic Russians, suppose Russian by nationality, preferred Russian, and just a slight majority of Ukrainians preferred Ukrainian. So in a way, you had a three large group in Ukrainian society: Ukrainians speaking Ukrainians, Russian speaking Ukrainians, and predominantly Russian speaking Russians. Ukrainian speaking Russians were minuscule. But that was much more adequate in terms of describing language practice in Ukraine, language preferences in Ukraine, you could say language processes in general, but it first underestimated the gap, the discrepancy between language preference in use and language preference in identity. So the people could still believe they are Ukrainian speakers, even though they basically spoke mostly Russian, or even primarily Russian. Yeah, and Dominique himself revealed that, detected that during his field work during the Ukrainian census of 2001, that people speaking with him and with everybody else who, whom he could observe only in Russian, nevertheless asserted, but I am not Russian, that's why I do not put my native language as Russian, so I still insist it's Ukrainian. So there was something which was about this importance of category of native language being as Dominique wrote himself is at the heart of their identity. Yeah, for these people who thought of themselves as Ukrainian but spoke Russian, and they took census as an occasion to declare that again. Census, as Dominique himself. Sorry, I'm referring to you too much. I will stop doing that. One final time, as his study of census as worldwide revealed, census is not just elicitation of kind of objective identity. It's a identity revealed in interaction. Yes, something which is a fact of social interaction rather than a fact of personality, regardless of interaction. This perception of discrepancy between different markers was for a long time not taken by social scientists, by survey quantitative leaning social scientists so much as to change thoroughly instruments of their surveys and the concepts they were working with. In the meantime, there appeared several micro studies going to particular places, and I'm happy to report that one of these places was Odessa, to which Vitaly Chernetsky kind of brought us in his presentation today. And one of these studies showed that even though in Odessa, in contrast to Lviv, which was another such place studied by micro scholars, people somehow thought of themselves as Russians and were perceived by outsiders as Russians, and there many challenge the any Ukrainian nature of Odessa at all, and that's why so many Western scholars were happy to write Odessa with two S to the chagrin of Ukrainians, yeah, and people probably are hungry. Nevertheless, if you observe them in a more detailed, a more intense interaction, many Odessans acquired some sense of Ukrainianness. Some believed that they didn't change their identity, didn't choose their identity. They just looked deep into themselves and realized they were Ukrainians all along. Instead, for a while, they just hadn't realized that. That's how this essentially thinking works. You know, you don't choose nationality. Everybody knows that. So if you realize you were Russian, probably you were Ukrainian. You were Ukrainian all along. You just didn't know that. And so these studies show that there is this change, but macro studies did not for a long time accept that as a reason to change their instrument, to change their questions, to change their concept. And remarkably, this change in identities went in one direction, from Russian to Ukrainian. Of course, you can imagine that if you analyze everybody, there are cases in going with changes in going in different direction. But this micro study in Odessa by Abel Oleze and Tanya Richardson didn't found such numerous and remarkable cases. I will now mention briefly my own research on these issues, which built on both previous work by quantitative macro studies and qualitative micro studies. And I started with conceptualizing native language as a special kind of identity, linguistic identity as distinct both from ethnic identity and from language practice. So a measure in its own. Many scholars before that somehow believed that native language is redundant. It just replicates, imperfectly replicates nationality and imperfectly measures language practice. So why use it at all? Some scholars did not even include it as measures in their analysis. So I included it together with nationality and language practice. I will not show you the table because that's about regressions. That's frightening. But I show that native language affects preferences, not just regarding language policy, but also regarding memory policy, foreign policy, no less than nationality or everyday language. That it is a measure in its own right, and it's important, and it should be kept, it should be maybe even focused on. And then I analyzed change patterns of identifications. Okay, so native language is important, as is nationality and everyday language. But how do people identify themselves? So this is especially after the Maidan, so much in public discourse was about new perception of oneself as a Ukrainian. Yeah, the Russian speakers in Russian wrote on Facebook or wrote in various fora on the internet or told in media interviews that I'm Ukrainian, and actually that's why they said they were fighting Putin, and that's why they didn't want to be protected as Russian speakers. And then of course the question is, do they want to stop being Russian speakers as to avoid being protected? Some did, but most did not. Most wanted to avoid being protected as Russian speakers without avoiding being Russian speakers. And that's something which made these dynamics even more fascinating. So I analyzed in three surveys the changing identifications by nationality and then in the next day by native language. And mind you, these data are comparable in terms of territory. So I, for 2012, I excluded here in this column, I excluded respondents from those territories which later became occupied. So these are data for the same territory, without Crimea and without those territories of the Donbass which are now occupied. So of course some people moved, there was migration and everything, but it happens all the time, maybe not on such a scale. We see there is a gradual, not drastic for Ukrainian, because it's 7% change. But if you look at Russian, it's reduced by half. So there is a big change, and moreover, this dynamics is not straightforward from Russians into Ukrainian. It includes an intermediate stage of double or hybrid identification. It reveals the role of hybridity as a special phenomenon which we should keep in mind in analyzing Ukrainian identity or probably any identity. Instead of immediately dropping their Russianness, or I call it shedding their Russianness in favor of Ukrainians, many people first acquired a new dimension, Ukrainian identity in addition to Russian identity. Probably that was the case for many Odessans or Kharkivans or Donetskis. But then gradually they shed Russianness altogether. And in the next survey, double identification reverted to the, in 2017 to the level of 2012, but Ukrainian identity increased and Russian identity further decreased. So that's same dynamic we have with native language, except that it kind of it started later. By 2014, nothing changed much. That's all within the margin of error. And by 2017, it rather drastically changed by 8% here. Next question I ask, if this people change their identifications, self-designations, from Russian to double to Ukrainian, is it still the same identity? Does it still mean the same? Can we still call this ethnic identity? the only source of these new Ukrainians are old Russians, yeah? Or first old doubles and then old Russians, yeah? Probably they know that their identity is not purely ethnic, not inherited from previous generations. Its identity they chose in view of their belonging to this country, in view of their belief in the right cause to stand up against Putin or something. Yeah, so they would know that their identity is not purely inherited, not purely ethnic. And I asked already, and actually I asked it already in 2012, but I didn't want to mix up. So I'm showing this next table right now. The question, as a follow-up to the question about who do you consider yourself by nationality, which I showed you earlier, here is different people determine their national belonging differently. Please tell how you determine their, your nationality. Yeah. So these are surveys by Key International Institute of Sociology, they are from my article in Post-Soviet Affairs in 2018 as a previous. Tables too. So the huge majority is still saying, claiming that they define their nationality by nationality of their parents, but we see a very significant drop from 2012 to 2014. Instead, a significant increase in their share of those who say they define their nationality by the country I live in, so civic identity rather than ethnic. So people, while scholars were still primarily, predominantly present nationality as ethnicity, mostly to avoid, Western scholars to avoid this perception nationality is citizenship. Yeah, so the nationalness was mostly translated into English as ethnicity to emphasize it is not citizenship. Out there, people significantly, already in 2012, one in six respondents said they chose their nationality by country, and in 2014 it's a quarter. Yeah, some by the language and some by the attitude. That's the choice I gave them. Normally, Ukrainians were more likely to perceive their nationality by country because the country was Ukrainian, they were Ukrainians, and Russians were more likely to perceive their nationality by language. So we are Russians, we speak Russian, so because we speak Russian, we consider themselves Russian, so not going with this general trend. But the shift was significant. But even more remarkably, in 2017, there was a partial reversion to the old pattern. You see here, the share of those who claim that they changed their nationality, they chose their nationality by nationality of parents, increases. And by the language, definitely decreases. And this is a small decrease, but for Ukrainian speakers, it's a significant decrease. So even though there is further shift from Russian to Ukrainian nationality, people believe that they are not changing their nationality by country, by attitude, by anything, by say they inherited. So this, the strength of this dominant perception of nationalist as inherited category, as unchangeable, something which just there is, what is your nationality, encourages people to answer this question in such a way. And you have lots of reflection of that in public discourse. How people claim they just realized, they discovered, they became aware, they finally reverted or something like that. So in elite discourse you find some admissions that's how I chose, that's what I want to be, and I will be no matter what other considers me. But definitely this process is remarkable, that people, this strength of essentialist thinking. And finally, I want to emphasize what have we learned, where have we moved. First, we realize that identities are changing, that these divisions are not stable, not carved in stone. Second, we realize that there are no stable groups. That resonates very much with the call by Rogers Brubaker to perceive ethnicity, not in terms of fixed and predominant groups. Ethnicity is process. Ethnicity is relation. That's how people view, how people think, how people perceive, how people live their lives in various interactions, and they can become more or less ethnic rather than just belonging to a certain fixed group. But that's not how people themselves perceive that. The dominant discourse encourages them to think of them as groups, as belongings, and that belongings as inherited. And of course, that the change and that discrepancy between actual practices of identifications and people's own perceptions of identification, this is what makes Ukraine even more fascinating. And finally, if we political scientists or other scholars using political science data come to study Ukraine, we should take these measures with caution. Measures are not what they seem to be. Measures are not necessarily what people themselves believe them to be. So we should be aware that there is no one indicator of ethnicity. Ethnicity is many things. It is only captured imperfectly by various things which are in the process of change. So if we look at different years, this ethnicity is in different relations, in a different in different aspects, is present in our measures. People and we cannot just switch to any different measures. First, there is no one measure, and second, to ask measures in surveys, we need to have a measure which people resonate with. People know what it is. Yeah, people have the idea what nationalist is. People have the idea what rednamova is. If we invent some new perception, people would not necessarily know what it is. So we live with these measures which are present and resonant in public discourse and have implications for people. But at the same time, we should be aware that it's not necessarily what actually happens in identifications and in the interaction. And that's what makes it for the future of Ukrainian identity studies. Thank you.
Okay, thank you everybody for inviting me to be part of this exciting event, and Professor Colton reminded me to talk fast, and I can guarantee you that. Although I think Volodya does a good job at that. I'm still not sure which one of us is speaking faster. But anyway, so for the last panel, I'll take that. Okay, so for the last topic that we have today, I'm going to in some way be echoing some of the things that we already said. As I kind of take stock of the process and challenges of nation building in Ukraine, from the early 1990s till today, but I'll be especially focusing towards kind of the new realities in what I believe have existed as far as political possibilities for certain nation-building projects after Euromaidan that were simply not politically possible before, and I'll talk more about why. And then I'll invite us maybe all to think perhaps towards Q&A if this is really something to celebrate or maybe something to be a little bit cautious about, right? So. So basically three things I want to talk about. First, briefly about what has the challenge of nation building consisted for in independent Ukraine after it gained its independence, how this challenge has been handled, especially by the political elites through the 1990s and early 2000s, and then what has changed in most recent period and what new projects have been put forth and how we might want to think about them going forward, right? So let me start with the first point here on this situation in Ukraine in the post-1991 period. So first of all, let me take a step back and say, what do I actually mean by nation building, right? We use the term quite loosely, right? Different people may mean different, slightly different things by this. I specifically here refer to the process by which political elite in any state, especially newly independent state, go through a variety of measures, anything from education sphere to politics, to various social initiatives to create this, to quote Anderson, imagined community. Basically, the community of people who identifies itself with the state and, you know, in whose name the state is constituted. So the nation is very important for the legitimacy of the state, because ultimately, you know, if there were no separate nations, why should we have separate states, right? We live in the world of nation states. Of course, in no country there is a perfect overlap between national boundaries and political boundaries, but that's kind of, you know, the idea is there among the political elites that they do need a nation, right? And that nation strengthens the state. So as far as, you know, taking this process to Ukraine, right, what were some of the challenges Ukraine faced when it becomes an independent state very rapidly, right? It was not kind of this extended centuries-year-old state and nation-building process, but Soviet Union collapses, new country emerges on the map almost overnight, right? And so there is sort of, now we have the state kind of in search of a nation. Right. In some sense, we could say Ukrainian state builders or nation builders had somewhat of a perhaps easier task, and ironically, not least due to the legacy of Soviet nationality policies that created ethnic categories for Soviet citizens. So Ukrainian state elites didn't have to turn "quote unquote" peasants into Frenchmen. There were already card-carrying or passport-carrying, right, ethnic Ukrainians, self-conscious people who identified as Ukrainian, although, as Volodya told us, you know, there is a lot of interesting kind of nuance and variation there that I'm not going to get into it, right? So, you know, with over 70% of the population of post-Soviet Ukraine, independent state, being ethnically Ukrainian, right, maybe things were not, you know, so bad as far as the creating a nation. On the other hand, of course, Ukraine was not a homogeneous country. There were a variety of ethnic and national minorities in Ukraine, not least of them an important and also geographically concentrated ethnic Russian minority. If we add to it, you know, the problem that many in Russia did not take the reality of Ukrainian independence well. And this kind of course, there was no territorial conflict up until recently, but, you know, various political elites in Russia, including in the liberal Yeltsin period, have spoken about, you know, the various historical injustices and sort of raised the question of territorial possibility of territorial revision. So Russians, of course, were always a very sensitive minority. But further, importantly, you know, again, as Volodya was elucidating in his talk, among this sort of passport-carrying, right, of ethnic Ukrainians, of course, there was also a variety of opinions, right? There were mixed Ukrainian, Russians, kind of Ukrainian slash Russian identity, Ukrainian speaking Ukrainians as opposed to Russian speaking Ukrainians. How exactly they sort of thought of themselves was very often complex and nuanced. Oftentimes, and again, scholars of Ukraine have remarked on this before, sort of seemingly incompatible attitudes towards the nation and the state coexisted in one person's head. People could simultaneously express their preference for sovereignty of the state and preservation of the Soviet Union. Who knows how they reasoned the two might go together, but clearly that was, you know, not an atypical way to think about in Ukraine. Even if we think back to the Soviet era and the independence referendum, of course, in the independence referendum in December 91, vast majority votes for independence, but just a few months earlier, in March of 1991, when there was a referendum on the preservation of renewed Soviet Union, also substantial majority in Ukraine voted for it. So either we have very rapid identity shift, like rather shifts in preferences towards these key issues, right? Like what kind of state do we want? Do we want a separate state? Do we want a common state? Right? And also potentially, you know, the same people, sort of these two ideas not being incompatible in their head, right? So so that goes to, you know, to show that the importance of this kind of creating a nation to support the newly independent state could not have been underestimated. And support for independent Ukraine was not set in stone. Again, as we all know, not only in political science, but, you know, more generally, yes, there was very high support for a referendum in December 1991, but then once economic crisis hits, right, and Ukrainian economy collapses, a lot of this support weakens, right? And already, you know, polling from early 1990s show substantially less, you know, fewer number of people in support for independence. So, right, so kind of on the societal level here, the reality was very complex as far as creating this unified nation that would back up and legitimize the existing state. Now, on the part of the state builders themselves, basically political actors who actively engaged in this process of nation building kind of from the top down, there was also a very peculiar situation, right? The reality was also quite complex. So the composition of the state, more specifically the composition of the Ukrainian political class, was also could be considered a challenge of nation building, right? So not just kind of the state of affairs and this blurred, multiple, oftentimes overlapping, conflicting identities and rapidly shifting preferences in the population, but also kind of the situation of the Ukrainian political class. So again, here my political science colleagues would forgive me for repeating sort of something that we have, you know, many of you have written about before, but I just kind of want to quickly give kind of a snapshot of what political class in Ukraine consisted of up until pretty much the Euromaidan revolution, and what these different elements of the political class wanted to as far as nation building. It has commonly been discussed, given the weakness of the overall political party system in Ukraine, that it doesn't really make sense to analyze Ukrainian political class as far as their belonging to specific parties, which changed often very rapidly and were not particularly meaningful, but as far as kind of the political camps, right? And the three relevant political camps in Ukraine from the late Soviet period were the so-called National Democrats, primarily associated with Rukh, right? Then they were kind of your nation builders par excellence. So they were the ones who were both ideologically committed to creating Ukrainian nation and had this idea of Ukraine being quote-unquote kind of normal nation state. Yes, with the rights for various minorities, but primarily, you know, the state was a Ukrainian majority, importantly, Ukrainian-speaking majority. So this sort of ethnic Ukrainians discovering, you know, Russified ethnic Ukrainians discovering their, you know, true language preferences, right? That's something that had to happen for kind of this abnormal situation of Russian-speaking Ukrainians to become normal again, right? Like Ukrainians had to come back to their roots, right? And also state explicitly distinct first and foremost from Russia, right? So any kind of identity narrative or nation building that had this fluid and permeable borders and kind of this relationship of some sort of like Russians are in some way my relatives, I'm not sure if I like them or not, but like, you know, we are sort of not really quite separate, like that was not really something that the National Democrats wanted to see. Instead, they wanted to emphasize how Soviet legacy and before that Tsarist legacy was clearly a history of oppression for Ukraine, right, and Ukrainians engaged in this quote-unquote national liberation struggle through the centuries, you know, against Polish domination, against Tsarist domination, eventually against Soviet domination, and then sort of this nation emerges, and it's very distinct, very separate from Russia, right? So that was kind of the emphasis, or, you know, the preference, I should say, of the National Democrats as far as nation building. Now, clearly, they did not have enough political support, if we're talking about especially the 1990s, early 2000s, to promote this agenda by themselves. Electorally, you know, Rukh and National Democrats never really held more than 25% of the seats in the national legislature, so they had to make alliances, right? And the only two other political elite groups with whom alliances could be made was, on the one hand, the unreformed communists of the Soviet Communist Party, the ones that did not back up independence, kind of we're talking about Simonenko and really conservative communists, right? And they were essentially on the complete opposite end of the spectrum as far as how they imagined Ukraine, what kind of nation-building projects they would, you know, they would support. They totally continued to buy into the Soviet narrative of the fraternal unity of the Russian-Ukrainian people and explicitly did not want and actively opposed any kind of policies that would make Ukraine more separate, kind of de facto and as an imagined community from Russia. So things, they instead would favor things such as dual and multiple citizenships, various reintegration, political, economic reintegration projects in the CIS, dual citizenship with Russia first and foremost, official bilingualism, right, the Ukrainian and Russian languages having equal official status, right, and also kind of this, again, continuation as far as historical memory of this common past, right, common origin of the Eastern Slavic people, Russians, Ukrainians, Belarusians, right? So communists were clearly, you know, in a completely different boat and completely different set of preferences for a nation, as far as nation building was concerned, from the National Democrats. And here we come to the third elite group that was very important, and again, it's not really, I'm not talking about one political party, but this so-called centrists, like who like to refer them to themselves as centrists, sometimes they're called, you know, variously sort of oligarchic parties, parties of power, but here we're basically talking about the old Soviet era elites who were not, you know, your dissidents or your committed nation builders, but who were essentially opportunists, right? People like Kuchma and Kravchuk and, you know, all the rest of them who have been, you know, some of them are still predominant in Ukrainian institutions, right? Also new economic elite who kind of, you know, this new rich capitalists who did not really care about nation building one way or the other, meaning that they didn't really lose any sleep sort of thinking about what is Ukrainian nation and who is Ukrainian, right? Like, yes, they, you know, were children, were educated in the Soviet discourse, but that was not their primary concern. Their primary concern was maintenance of political power and economic, control of economic resources, basically to enable themselves, to enrich themselves. But they were interested, right, exactly because they wanted to control the state. they were, I would say, strategically, maybe there is a better term, like not ideologically, but kind of materially interested, right, in nation building, exactly because it served their interest, right? If there was a nation kind of underlying the state that gave the legitimacy to the state, that made the state kind of stronger, more secure, by extension, the rule of the state was made more secure, right? So they essentially were this kind of strange bedfellows, or I think Taras Kuzio put it like uneasy alliance, right, between National Democrats and this party of power, right, the centrist kind of post-Soviet political and economic elite that essentially engaged in nation-building project that the nationalists or National Democrats themselves were not able, would not have been able to implement. But importantly, right, this nation-building project that Kuchma and Kravchuk, right, and, you know, pursued in Ukraine essentially up until the Orange Revolution was not exactly the same thing that the Ruch and National Democrats themselves would want. I'm just going to give you like a few examples, right? For example, like, yes, the status of Ukrainian as the only state language was something that they were able to agree upon, right? Again, a lot of these elites, you know, Kuchma, Yanukovych, all of them, they spoke Russian, right? But they understood the importance of state language, right, as kind of the symbolic measure that basically strengthens Ukraine as a state and makes it distinct from other states first and foremost from Russia, right? So as long as, you know, they were still able to, you know, to speak Russian and, you know, in the, essentially that's the situation that we saw, any of us who did surveys, interviews in Ukraine in the 1990s, and you would go to a government office and you would conduct an interview in Ukrainian, and as soon as the interview is over and the person you're interviewing is talking with the colleague in the elevator, they're speaking in Russian, right? And that was kind of the state of affairs, right? So yes, Ukrainian was a state language, it had the symbolic significance, the party of power agreed on this, right? But, you know, de facto, there was not much as far as sort of actual Ukrainization or active measures. You know, again, not even Ukrainian language films, like up until 2005. Yes, Ukrainian language schooling, but also with quite a lot of regional variation with the South and the East in particular, and Crimea having much less of Ukrainian language schools, right? So that's sort of one example, right? Like another, again, some of the really key issues, we talked about it in the previous historical panel, right? Like what kind of elements of history would be emphasized? On the one hand, there was kind of rediscovering of the blank pages from the Soviet period, and yes, discussion about the famine, but at the same time, no kind of strong this Holodomor is a genocide of the nation, that would not come up until Yushchenko would take presidency, right? So in the 1990s, again, the centrist so-called political class did not want to go in that direction, kind of, you know, that version of nation building too far, right? By the same token, if we're talking about, say, the period of the Second World War and the role of Ukrainian nationalist underground, the OUN and the UPA, they did not receive any official status, again, something the National Democrats would want very much, you know, equally with status of the veterans who fought on the Soviet side. That did not happen, right? So there was some kind of local acknowledgement in Western Ukraine in particular, and, you know, some of them received additional pensions from local government, but not at the national level, right? So this process of nation building, right, this is why I put the term muddling through here. This is sometimes how this period has been referred to. So there was, you know, certain differences from the Soviet period. There was some sort of deconstruction of the Soviet narrative, but still the sort of ultimate question, like, could you simultaneously, you know, speak Ukrainian and Russian? Like, could Ukraine be, you know, like, Ukrainian nation? Does it have to reject its, say, Russian and Soviet heritage completely, or could it somehow incorporate and kind of find this mixed and kind of unclear and confusing, but somehow some joint past was still okay, right? With the language education, right? Is it like, do you have to make, you know, it's really Ukrainian, not just on paper, but really in practice during the breaks and so forth? Or can you just kind of keep it at the symbolic level and let, you know, at the actual level, you know, if Russian remains spoken, so be it, right? So this sort of, this kind of muddled nation building policy, and I'm not going to, I mean, maybe this is the question we should all think about, like, is it like good or bad? I mean, one way to say it, well, that was actually incomplete nation building, it was, and I think many people might think this, right? But I mean, another way to look at it would be that it was sort of like a more pluralistic approach that may be potentially, you know, better suited towards not allowing, you know, disagreements at the local level to boil out because, you know, people were still able to kind of express whatever views that they wanted and speak whatever language that they wanted and, you know, not be forced to celebrate, you know, certain holidays and commemorate certain tragedies if they personally or, you know, the residents of the region did not feel like it. I'm not going to take a view on this because I'm myself kind of, you know, I'm not sure what I actually think. I keep thinking about it a lot and I'm still not sure. But anyways, I wanted to present kind of, you know, to you how it was. Now, moving forward, right, because I don't want to take too much time and leave time for discussion. So this model nation building exists basically, you know, from until 1991. more or less until Euromaidan, with the two important exceptions, which is the period of the Orange Revolution, after the Orange Revolution and Yushchenko presidency, and then Yanukovych returned to power before his overthrow in 2014. So what was different then, right? So under Yushchenko, there was this, after Yushchenko was elected, there is this attempt on the part of the state to kind of move the nation-building process in really this more kind of activist direction favored by the National Democratic right all along. So to make, in particular, in the memory politics, right, this emphasis on Holodomor as the genocide of the Ukrainian people, attempts to legalize the UN and the UPA and may give them the status, official status of the war veterans. We can say Yushchenko was maybe partly successful. I mean, I guess, again, one depends how one views Yushchenko presidency and whether one even agrees that these kinds of measures that he was trying to institute were desirable in the long term and so forth. But, you know, his attempts to legalize the UN and the UPA fail, but certainly the attempt to kind of elevate the importance of Holodomor in national memory succeed. I mean, if we look at the opinion polls now, I think well over 70% of Ukrainians, maybe even as high as 80, now believe that Holodomor was a genocide, although the important caveat, genocide of the Ukrainian people and not of the Ukrainian nation. That was an addition that was put in the law by the Socialist Party when this Holodomor's genocide bill was discussed. Again, how one understands the difference between Narod and Nazia, you know, that might, but that's an important caveat. But still, right, so we can say sort of Yushchenko partly succeeds, but certainly not fully in kind of moving nation building in this direction. And of course, it generates a lot of resentment and dissatisfaction and backlash. That was not the main reason, or maybe not, certainly not the only reason, and I would say not the main reason why he loses presidency in 2010. Of course, there were a lot of corruption and all this infighting with Timoshenko, but certainly it made it easier, right, for, we can say, the proponents of kind of this more pro-Russian or Russia-friendly narrative, right, historical and identity narrative, to then gather votes in the south and the east, which brings to power Yanukovych, who essentially does like 180 degrees turnaround, right? And, you know, this talk about Holodomor's genocide has been downgraded. Holodomor is now kind of common, the tragedy of the Soviet people. That was one of the first things that, you know, Yanukovych does. ONU UMPA recognition is off the agenda. And very controversially, also Yanukovych pushes through this language law that makes Russia, Russian language, that gives it the status of a regional language. And I'm not gonna go, for the sake of time, say more about it, but at least to say that kind of the main goal of this was not really creation of true bilingualism, but essentially to make Ukrainian redundant and unnecessary in the south and the east. So it was not, you know, so the goals of this legislation, right, again, were kind of blurring the boundaries and sort of keeping, you know, Russian and Russian-ness, we can say, firmly vested in Ukraine. So moving on to, right, to the period of Euromaidan, right, so the post-1994 reality. So what changes? With, and here it's sort of, maybe something I'll say might be a little bit ironic, but I think this stronger nation and kind of more activist nation building that we see now, and I'm going to talk in a second what I mean by this, really we can thank, or we should thank, or we could thank Putin for it, right? As kind of weird as it might seem. Why do I say that? Because with the annexation of Crimea, and the conflict and occupation of parts of the territories of Donbas. Essentially, Ukrainian electoral geography changes profoundly. We have completely cutting out from the voting rolls the most kind of Russia-friendly, right, pro-Russian electorate, whereby the situation becomes that it completely changes the composition of Ukrainian parliament. The 2014 elections that bring for the first time nearly a constitutional majority of pro-Western parties. So this kind of threefold division, and the communists are completely out for the first time, not a single seat, right? So this threefold division between sort of ambiguous kind of post-Soviet opportunistic center and, you know, smaller but not insignificant kind of national democratic right, and then substantial but again not majority left communist kind of vested to still the Soviet identity narrative, that is completely off. The completely change is completely upended. And again, I think the fact that, you know, really we have this major territorial realignment is the reason for it. So what happens, right, like once now this parliament really has for the first time in modern Ukrainian history this majority of these, you know, whatever term you want to use, like pro-Western, you know, pro-Ukrainian, anti-Russian, you know, terminology, matters parties, right? It basically means that many of these nation-building initiatives, right, nation-building plans or projects or kind of visions that before simply could not be passed as made into the law just because the numbers did not line up in Ukrainian parliament, you know, given the outcome of the elections and this persistent, you know, split, now that has changed, right? And Ukrainian parliament is able to pass for legislation such as on decommunization, right, equating Soviet essentially Nazi symbols, right, banning the, you know, the so-called propaganda of communist and Nazi symbols, including, you know, various Soviet kind of, you know, issues central to Soviet identity, the UN and the UPA elevated in status officially as fighters for Ukrainian independence, right? This decommunization law has also vast implications, and as you all know, for renaming of the streets, you know, tearing down of the Soviet monuments and all of these things, right? Again, something that wasn't done in the previous 25 years, except, you know, in some parts of Western Ukraine. So this sort of, like, who was that Ukrainian who said, hate with Moscow, right? Historians tell me, huh? Okay, so we now have this, like, really hate with Moscow, right? Away from Moscow, right? At the state level, right? With this explicit nation-building policies. This law on the Russian as a regional language was recently declared unconstitutional, right? And most recent initiative coming from the president of Ukraine, maybe Reverend Hudziak is here, maybe he can tell us a little bit more about it or what he thinks about it. I didn't get a chance to ask yesterday about the church, right? So this idea that independent state and independent nation should also have its own independent national church. So this, you know, newly activated push to have Constantinople Patriarch to give autonomous status, you know, and have Ukrainian church essentially, you know, the question would be what becomes with the Moscow Patriarchy and church and so forth, right? So the last thing I want to mention, right, like I want to kind of invite us all to think about, like, is this something that we should be celebrating? In other words, the sort of this activist nation building, right? Or is this something to kind of maybe think about cautiously and say, well, is this, even though, like, the Ukrainian political class now can do it, right? They can pass all these measures that before they simply could not because political geography was different. What about people in Ukraine who still, yes, they're admittedly now in a minority, but they're still not buying into this nation-building agenda, right, and these measures on decommunization, certain interpretations of the Second World War, right, the role of the Ukrainian national standing ground, the kind of the history of Ukraine with Russia, to what extent Russia is Ukraine's other, and so forth. What to do about it? Like, should these people just be ignored and basically say, well, you know, too bad, we can now get away with it, therefore we will, right? Or should Ukrainian state be kind of making more efforts to reach out to these people who are, for a variety of ways, have not bought into this nation-building agenda, right? And maybe this is something that we can think about altogether. But I want to show you before, you know, I end, and that was, you know, basically my concluding kind of comment, just to show you, you know, on the one hand, echoing what Volodya said, that there is this sort of greater identification with the Ukrainian state. So there is certainly, this nation-building is not just state-driven process. There are certainly processes within society, and there are greater number of Ukrainians, you know, rediscovering, you know, their Ukrainian identity or newly re-identifying as Ukrainians, right, feeling proud of being Ukrainian citizens. But this is not to say that there is still not a sizable minority that feels very differently. So I'm going to just show you a few slides here, right? This is the first kind of on the glass half full and then glass half empty side, right? So this is the data on, a lot of it comes from this newly released book, and it's available in English and PDF by Oleksiy Harany and I forgot the other person's name. I had it actually. Not Bekeshkin. It was Yakovlev. I think. Anyways, which sort of is a collection of various opinion polls on these, you know, very important issues, and you can look at it there, right? So this is from you know, the same poll, right? So if we look at, for example, who do you consider yourself to be first and foremost? Here the citizen of Ukraine, right, has become clearly, you know, greater number of people consider themselves citizens of Ukraine than, for example, you know, local identity. But see how different the picture is in Donbass, right? So in Donbass, it's actually a decrease, and we're talking about government-controlled Donbass here, right? People, there is a decrease in identification with the state, right? An increase, for example, in identification with the oblast and the region, right? So there's clearly some sort of search for a new identity in Donbass, right? And again, something to think about, like if Ukrainian state does not go with the proposal of Andruhovich and others to just, you know, let these regions go and build the wall, which Ukrainian state elites gave no indication that this is what they plan to do, then the question becomes, how do you reach out to people who have very different views and sort of different self-understandings and different identity, we might say, right? Here, the support for the Russian language, right, again, clearly, you know, we see this shift, actually, ironically, at the same year when under Yanukovych, they pushed in this law on the Russian as regional language, right? There has been a decline of people who favor supporting, you know, giving Russian some sort of status, right? An increase of people who oppose to this. So certainly, you know, one state language policy is not something that is going to lead to, like, mass demonstrations, right? So the state can get away with doing this, right? At the same time, there are a substantial number of people, and not insignificant number of people, who either find it difficult to say or who want to have Russian some sort of status, right? Like, should it be at the regional level? Should it be something decided by municipalities, right? That would be something to be discussed, you know, by nation builders, or it could be something to say, like, you know what, one nation, you know, one state, one language, end of story, you don't like it, go to Russia, right? And, you know, we do hear these kinds of things expressed. So if we look at the here support for the various types of unions, right, economic union, EU, or customs union, again, kind of on the plus side, we see there is clearly not even so much, I mean, there is an increase in support for the EU, but drastic decrease in support for joining anything, you know, customs union with Russia and Belarus, right? But at the same time, there is also a greater number of people who favor joining nothing or who are undecided, right? So again, kind of this identity that is not does not neatly fit into this traditional, you know, state-nation building agenda that the National Democratic and center-right have long favored, right? Like, what about reaching out to these people? The same we can see on NATO, right? On the plus side, if that's, you know, considered the plus side, there are certainly, I guess now, fewer people would vote against NATO, right, if there was a referendum, not so many would for, right? But again, we see this increase kind of undecided, don't know, hard to say, right? If you want to really kind of put, you know, a positive spin on changes in attitudes of NATO, this is from the same book, the poll where people only who said they would vote in the referendum, how they would answer, right? So if there was actually a referendum on NATO, it looks like it would pass, right? But again, we're talking about 25-30%, you know, anywhere probably between 20 or like upper teens and upper 20s, right, who really feel differently. What about them, right? Like, could they be just written off, or should nation building include some sort of reaching out for this community? Great differences among regions remain, right? Volodya is right, and I mean, his paper and other papers on this post-Soviet affairs go into great detail, kind of exploring changes in attitudes also within different regions, and it's definitely true that not just in the West and the center, but in the East and the South, there has been change and kind of there has been increase in, you know, we can say broadly pro-Ukrainian sentiment, but there are still, you know, very strong sentiments in large numbers of the population there who feel very differently, right? So here, if we have granting Russian language status, right, it is very different picture in the South and the East than it is in the West and the center, right, and in Donbass as well. So again, I just kind of going here by way of illustration, great differences if we look at attitudes towards different forms of political unions like EU versus customs union across regions, right? I mean, the picture speaks for itself. The same on NATO, right? So these regional differences that we talked about, right, that persisted in Ukraine, they have not completely disappeared. Yes, they may have diminished. Yes, they may have changed, right? But they certainly have not disappeared, which I think, you know, again, brings me to this point that I keep making. Is this more kind of assertive, traditional nation building really what Ukraine needs at this point? Now, what would happen, right? And here we have just one such policy of the newly activist nation building that the post-Euromaidan government implemented was the banning of the Russian various media and social platforms, including this ВКонтакте and the Klasniki kind of Facebook equivalents, right? Certainly arguments could be made that at the time, you know, of the Russian aggression, given the propaganda and, you know, the control of these resources, you know, by the Russians, you know, potentially FSB and people get in trouble, whatever, right? Like, that was actually not necessarily, you know, a bad thing to do, right? And maybe it's understandable what it was done, but it remains very unpopular, right? So people are not really liking this. Now, what are we to make of it, right? Some might say, well, they don't like it, but they're gradually moving to Facebook. I had not a significant number of my classmates who were at these websites now have migrated to Facebook, right? And we can say, like, well, whatever, you know, over time, like, they're gonna forget and so forth, right? But, and this is the last slide I'll put forth, a lot of people are dissatisfied in Ukraine with where things are going, right? Here I'm not talking about, you know, nation building specifically, but more like if the country is going in the wrong direction. And we can imagine, like, we don't have to sort of be too pessimistic, but you can certainly imagine various not very happy scenarios, right, whereby, say, post-Euromaidan government gets discredited, is already, you know, pretty unpopular, kind of, and by extension, you know, various policies that this government stands for, including this kind of nation building, right, gets, you know, the protest vote. And maybe, even though I think mathematically it would be now much more difficult for any kind of sort of pro-Russian force to come, you know, to come back to power, but if, you know, we continue, there remains a large percentage of dissatisfied people, you know, who are also regionally concentrated, right, who are sort of still to be left out by this, you know, project that post-Euromaidan Ukraine pursues, right, there could be substantial potential for the protest vote, with consequences being quite unpredictable. I'm not necessarily saying this is something that would happen, but I think this is something that we should be aware about as we, you know, study and celebrate perhaps, you know, this kind of newly regenerated success of Ukrainian nation building and strengthening of the Ukrainian nation after 2014. Thank you.
So everybody's had a chance, right?
Yep.
Okay, great. time should we finish? It's 4:32. You're the chief.
I guess 20 minutes maybe for discussion.
20 minutes for discussion. All right, very good. So let's just open it up and we'll start right here.
What a very good question. Again, I enjoyed all of the talk. Thank you all very much. This is for you, Mr. Kulyk. I believe, let's see, this was a 2004 poll. I could be wrong. But if I'm not mistaken, it indicated that 58% of people spoke Ukrainian. Correct? 58% spoke Ukrainian. And then there was an interesting question. What percentage of people speak only Ukrainian all day in all functions? And the number was, again, I can't quite remember, it was either 4% or 6%, remarkably low. So in 2004, if that, assuming that, that those numbers are correct, what would the tendency be like in more recent years? Thank you.
Should
we
answer one
more?
Sure.
Yeah. This might also be for you. So.
Okay, thank you. So that's an essential feature of Ukrainian society. It is bilingual. Bilingual practice on a societal level, and bilingual practice even on individual level for most individuals, should be accepted as an important and at least for a while unavoidable aspect of Ukrainian society, but should not be projected as part of people's identification necessarily, and a part of people's political and linguistic preferences. So. It's like you ask Hispanic people in the US how many of you can function exclusively in Spanish. Yeah, some can in ghettos. Yeah, in places where predominant majority are Hispanics. But they can survive in Spanish only if they never leave that enclave. Yeah. So that's what happens to a language which is not full-fledged in all social roles on all of its territory, which is not dominant, let's say, not fully a majority language. So in this way, this figure has increased, but not much, I would guess.
Really?
So it is increased precisely because there are many people who are dissatisfied with their inability to function exclusively or predominantly in Ukrainian. Again, I will not discuss with Oksana whether it's a good thing or bad thing. Some Ukrainian speakers might go too far in wanting to be kind of racial, in this case, maybe, I mean, of course, linguistically pure Ukrainian, yeah? Which is not necessarily a good thing, but because what to do with others, yeah? Should we kill them? Should we expel them? Yeah, so there are implications of that preference. But assuming they want to live with them,
yes.
but make them respect their preference, and to the same extent as they are respecting their preference. Yeah. So for a long while, Ukrainian bilingualism was asymmetrical. Russian speakers were able to live primarily
in Russian.
Ukrainian speakers were not. Yeah. So that dissatisfaction grows. To the extent this asymmetry becomes more obvious and becomes more unacceptable at the time of war, at the time of aggression, at the time of this perceived protection of Russian speakers, so they come to kill us under the pretext of protection, and we are still tolerating that. So many more people require demand a change in that. Many more people say enough is enough. Of course, easier said than done, because so many people, so many Russian speakers accepted that they can live in Russian elsewhere, anywhere, in all social roles, in all periods of life, in all kinds of social interactions. So, and one thing, if we talk about how we should normatively treat that, one thing we should be doing, as scholars, as public intellectuals in Ukraine, as advisors to those in power who are willing to listen to us, is to make clear that there is a distinction between your role as an employee and your rights as citizen. And one way in which you can increase the presence and visibility and confidence of Ukrainian and Ukrainian speakers without violating the rights of Russian speakers and producing increasing their dissatisfaction with the government is to disentangle these roles. So as an employee, I have the obligation to speak Ukrainian. As a citizen, I have full right to use Russian in those practices which are not fully regulated by the government. But those practices are not so many, but the failure to produce services in Ukrainian increases dissatisfaction and then radical insistence on the use of Ukrainian error.
Tim, we have very briefly,
we have 20 minutes, and one answer, one question just took up 7.5 minutes, so we're going to have to do it concisely.
Very briefly.
Yeah, okay.
Two things. Language accommodation. The practice in Ukraine has been that basically if there's a Ukrainian speaker with a Russian speaker, then the switch will be to Russian. I've got a doctoral student who's just submitted. She worked on the volunteers in the east, in Dnipropetrovsk, Odessa, and Kharkiv, massively Russian speakers, because that's the language of convenience. But she's observed over time that they actually now make an effort no longer to accommodate Russian, to insist on, that is, the other will accommodate them, no, the answer is no, keep speaking Ukrainian. So you see a little trend. The second point, in terms of the ability to speak Ukrainian, let's say to power, or to civil servants, to be served, or to in a shop, you know, in a restaurant. Ukraine, unfortunately, is still as a weak legal culture, and certainly among civil servants. So that's a larger issue. That even if you pass regulation, you still have this mentality that basically, as a civil servant, I do what I want. So to keep that in mind.
Okay, great. Can I recognize you, please?
Hello, does this work? Okay, thank you very much. I have a very brief comment and then two quick questions. So thank you for all the papers. The first comment and question is for Professor Arel on the topic of doctoral studies, because I, until very recently, was a doctoral student. Specifically in terms of your comment that the field of Ukrainian studies has been legitimized. And I think that, as we've seen in this wonderful conference, yes, of course, but I would also suggest that there's still a long way to go. And specifically, I would say, having finished my dissertation, and at least at Toronto, but I think it's also the case in many universities in North America, you have to publish it electronically with ProQuest, which I believe is an American-based company. And in that dissertation filing online publishing system, there is no Ukrainian studies. There are only Russian studies. So I am sure that people are aware of this, but I'm surprised that this hasn't been raised in terms of doctoral studies. And I don't know who is the person classifying dissertations at ProQuest who's responsible for this. I tried to find out through the University of Toronto library system. But I think that's interesting in terms of legitimacy of the field, that it's still not possible to officially do a dissertation in Ukrainian studies according to the widespread North American ProQuest electronic filing system. And then my question was, you raised a very interesting issue of the high number of female graduate students, and I wonder if this is maybe also a wider reflection of trends in not just higher education, but education as a whole, including high school, of completion rates for women are for some reason higher than for young men, which is sort of troubling, I think. So my question would be, you know, is this a phenomenon specific to Ukrainian studies, or is this rather reflective of general North American educational trends? And then my second question to the other speakers was, I was just curious what language the surveys are carried out in. Are they in Ukrainian, framing questions about language, politics, identity, etc.? Are they asked bilingually, Russian, Ukrainian, and if so, what question gets put at the top? Or how do you negotiate questions about identity and language without kind of subconsciously prompting an answer? So I was curious to know how people approach that issue. Thank you very much.
When I said the field has been legitimized, I meant from the bottom up. I mean, it's basically among graduate students, the fact that you've got half with no direct personal biographical connection to Ukraine choosing to work on a topic entirely focused on Ukraine or partially, depending, to me is an example of legitimacy. You know, it's mainstream now. It's no longer an issue. It's actually attractive. But what you raise, of course, is absolutely legit. that is, you know, it's bureaucracy, it's the departments, it's power. It's basically now there's a great deal of resistance, no question about that. But among students, and as for gender, there's no question about it. And again, overall in the seminar, it's 55-45, so you see a predominance now of women. We see that in our classes, and at ASN last week, we gave prizes to 7 doctoral students in 7 different fields, including Ukraine, and all of them were women, which is, you know, outside of the norm. But that we have nearly 90% of doctoral students in Ukraine that is coming to our seminar or Ukraine-born women, I mean, that's not normal. There's something going on in Ukraine here that makes it completely out of whack, which, again, is an absolute reversal from the previous generation.
Did you answer on the survey question?
Yeah, many could have done that no more than me. All major companies offer questionnaires in both languages, and some ask at the beginning which they want, and then register as a choice, which is a measure in itself. And Dominique was co-designer of another scheme, and when the interviewer comes to your place and starts interacting, you switch it back and forth without making his or her own choice prominent, yeah, and tries to elicit what language you prefer, and then continues in the language which is establishes an interaction as supposed language of your choice.
I have Bob Hunter, please. Yep. Right here.
Very quick, and I'll try to be very quick, but can I resist the comment of our young colleague here? If we were in Europe and they would be taking a kind of measures of what we've agreed to in this conference, which of course we don't do in North America, but nonetheless this reminds me of what was done in the 60s and 70s, a campaign, because this actually is very important, should be done. We did carry out campaigns with the Library of Congress to reclassify the way material. So it seems to me that this is now something that really should be done quite seriously. I'm going to try to speak as quickly as our colleague Oksana, but I don't think I can do that.
Nobody
can. Exactly. So let's not waste time. I have Volodymyr Kulyk talked about the kind of dual identities and was almost suggesting that this is something new. First of all, of course, we all know multiple identities are the norm in every society, at every time. And when it comes to nationality building, as took place in the 19th century, running up to the present, completely normal for all peoples who had no states. By definition, they had to have, when thinking in these categories, more than one identity. So I don't see this even remotely as something new. And of course, we know in the 19th century, we would have in an ethnic category, Little Russian, and in a state category, Russian. Two completely normal, compatible multiple identities. And if it was in the Habsburg Empire, it would be Ruthenian or Ukrainian versus, and then Austrian Habsburg. And then if it was the Soviet period, Ukrainian and Soviet as an identity, or Russian and Soviet. And then in independence, the Russians might become Ukrainian as a state identity, and the Ukrainians, Ukrainian. So I'm surprised why you suggest that this is somehow something new when it is old and normal.
Thanks so much for raising this point. You give me an opportunity to emphasize, which I failed to emphasize in my talk. First, when I'm saying that's new to our understanding of Ukrainian identity, because as I presented, they started with this government-led division of Ukrainian society by nationality, and the state-led division. And state always wants, as Foucault taught us, always wants people to have their unique identities, to be easily governable, to be clear, understandable, and governable. You have to just have one cell, yeah, for everybody. You cannot have ambiguous and ambivalent and whatever. Second, your double identities and many other
multiple
triple, quadruple, and whatever identities normally come from different kinds. You can have one ethnic identity, one linguistic identity, one sexual identity, one occupational identity, and one political identity. What's new here is that I presented identity which we see, for example, Ukrainian identity, and the same way Russian identity, less but also to an extent, is a mixture of unknown kinds. You cannot say that those having Ukrainian and Russian identity have a clear Russian ethnic identity and a clear Ukrainian political identity. It's not the case. Probably for most of them now, their political identity is Ukrainian. Even for those, for some, it is still with this East Slavic identity or whatever. Until recently, very many of them felt ambiguous about their political identity. But remarkably, their ethnic identity is mixed too. So their ethnic identity is a mixture of Ukrainian and Russian in portions which we don't know and which are changing. The meanings they attach to their Ukrainian identity are changing and not fully transparent, because what they tell you in a survey that is not necessarily what they reveal in other interactions. So that means that this double identity is anything but a mixture of clear-cut elements, which is what normally was observed in those cases you referred to. That's...
I mean, for what it's worth, worth paying attention to what goes on in Russia in this area as well, because I would say confusion is growing about what some of these categories mean. And Putin has called for a debate on this, and not really push it, because I don't think he knows what he wants. So Rossiyskaya Nazia, for example, is this phrase he's been using. All right, very good. So the next hand I saw was a gentleman on the staircase.
Question to Dominique and one to Paul. To Dominique, please tell us what the Danilov seminar is. Is it a week-long gathering, a semester-long gathering, or what is it? And to Paul, you had mentioned some of the authors who've been writing about Ukraine who don't really know much about Ukraine. I think that's a much broader phenomenon. If you add in articles and op-eds and so on and so forth, any understanding as to why there are so many people claiming to know what they're writing about when they write about Ukraine, when in fact they don't?
Yeah, of course, I should have said more about the Danube seminar. It's a three-day event, so an annual seminar or workshop for which is about 30 international participants, up to 20 presentations. But now we're mixing films, we're bringing filmmakers on contemporary topics and book panels. But the core is between 15 and 20 presentations based on papers, and about a third from doctoral students, so very intense. If it were to last a week, we wouldn't get past the fourth day.
You've asked me a gigantic question. The short version I will give is that there are a lot of outlets looking for content, and there are a lot of places for people to express themselves freely. But in particular, in this case, it was this conflict that for almost everybody was very surprising. And so if you think you're a big shot in international relations, you're going to write about it. And you don't have time. I mean, the rapidity with which some of these books came out was astonishing. You don't have time to learn about Ukraine, but you may have a colleague who knows something, or you may have been to Russia. And this is what happened. I mean, I won't, you know, you can pick apart some of these books and the misconceptions in them. The other thing, though, is at another level, is due to what's happening in the publishing industry, most of the reporting from Kiev is done from Moscow. And in fact, a lot of the political scientists who might think they know something about Ukraine have spent most of their time in Russia. And so some of them have spent enough time in Ukraine, so you'd say, okay, fair, but some of them haven't, of course. And if you spend your time in Moscow and learn about Ukraine, what are you going to learn? So that's a short version of it, but it's a big, complicated story.
Jim, can I make a quick, this is 30-second reactor response to that? 15 years ago or so, New York Times, talking about preparation for discussion of Ukraine, including linguistic preparation,
the explanation in the New York Times as to why we should now refer to that country as Ukraine and not the Ukraine. The reason is that the Ukrainians decided to drop the article in their own usage, and therefore we should as well.
But the style guides, the AP style guide still has Kiev spelled K-I-E-V, not K-Y-I-V, because the AP, which is what everybody in the journalism world follows, has not made the jump yet.
But then you have to change Moscow to Moscow.
Well, exactly, and I'm not saying that it should be, it's just it's something I actually gave a presentation recently in which I got berated for my pronunciation of the name of that city, and I said, I'm an American, give me a break, but it didn't work.
Okay, I saw a hand here, and I guess we're going to have to stop after this.
Oksana mentioned something on the church. What I'm curious about is why, given the political situation, would Poroshenko decide to go for what seems to be broke on the church issue? And I'll give a supposition that I have, is that the church has been much more successful at maintaining a Russian bastion and aligned to Moscow than almost any other political structure in Ukraine. I was stunned that in Kherson Oblast, if one priest who spoke Ukrainian was pushed out of the church. But you know, how do you see this? Is this a good calculation on his part?
Yeah, I mean, obviously,
of course, we don't know what's going
to
happen.
It's hard to know if Poroshenko knows something that we don't, right? But I mean, I think broadly speaking, I mean, I see it as a part of this nation building kind of vision that, you know, like all things aligning, right? This congruence, like the political nation, right? The ethnic, sort of linguistic, and religious component is sort of, I think it is an argument that makes the nation stronger. There is sort of this idea, right? Now, specifically with Poroshenko, I think it is election time, so he must be betting on the fact that he can get some political dividend out of this. Now, of course, if this project were to fail, in other words, now he riled up enough people in the Rada that they signed this letter to the Patriarch in Constantinople asking Patriarch to give Ukrainian church whatever they term it, like, what is the terminology? There is like some specific...
Autocephalous.
Right. Autocephalous. Yes. So, I mean, if you think about it, I mean, this is why, like, Reverend Budiak was here yesterday, I was really hoping maybe he can, you know, enlighten us for what's going on, because even if Patriarch agreed, which I think is a huge if, because the Patriarch doesn't want to spoil relations with Moscow, and I think for Moscow that would be yet another red line, like, you know, with the... Right. But even if Patriarch agreed, it still leaves the issue of divided churches in Ukraine, right? Because who are they going to be united under, right? The three Orthodox churches, the Autocephalous, the Kiev Patriarchy, and the Moscow Patriarchy. The Moscow Patriarchy doesn't want to hear anything about it. Yesterday, I think George Soroka is here. Was saying, he just left, that he talked to some, you know, people in the Moscow Patriarchy, and apparently there is a split within Moscow Patriarchy. So it is quite possible that if Patriarch in Constantinople okayed that, then the Moscow Patriarchy in Ukraine would split, and some of it would join, with the... So, and again, sort of talking about, right, like, could they get away with it? Probably, maybe now they could, right? I mean, there has been an exodus of believers in Ukraine after the Russian aggression from the parishes, from the Moscow Patriarchy to Kiev Patriarchy churches. Before, people didn't really care. I mean, it was more like about the priest. I mean, the Viviski, the signs, they usually just say Pravoslavna Tserkva, like Orthodox Church. They don't really specify what patriarchy it is, right? Mm-hmm. But now people kind of became more like aware of, like, okay, do I really want to be in the Moscow Patriarchy, right? So maybe this is the calculation, right? Like maybe there is, you know, whoever advises him sees that Patriarch might sign off on this, and then they kind of envisage the plan how they would actually push it through within Ukraine. Like, that's all I can think of. Because I think if it was like a priori a failure, you're right, like before elections, that would seem like a silly thing to do. So maybe they're banking on, I don't know if anybody has more information, but that's like the reason.
Yeah.
So anybody without real internal connection to Bankova knows in Ukraine, it is of course a big plan to boost Poroshenko's popularity now with this Josephus Church idea, and it's a great move in the nation building direction in response to this growing or strong perception that things go wrong. But one thing I think was unfortunate in your presentation is somehow implication that the high percentage of people perceiving that things are going wrong in Ukraine necessarily relate to this nationalizing or strong nation building. No, you didn't say that, but you showed one slide right next to the other. And we should understand that there are many reasons to be dissatisfied, to perceive that things go wrong. And dominant discourse is about corruption in Ukraine. And dominant discourse is about low standards of living. And whether or not people are so strongly dissatisfied with national building, we don't know. It might be that to many Russian speakers or to many minorities, it is the case. But that should definitely be kept separate analytically, and then kept separate in terms of agenda for our research. But for political purposes, definitely, that's one reason for them. They cannot quickly, or they don't want to quickly get rid of corruption. They don't want to, or cannot quickly kind of redistribute so national wealth to make people more well-to-do. What they can do is to produce some remarkable, noticeable identity shifts. And memory politics is one of them. For a long time, we thought nation would be, language would be another one. Like this new comprehensive language law, probably they decided it's risky, it's counterproductive in electoral terms, so probably now they're betting on this religious card. But whether or not it happens is not clear, but definitely the more unpopular Poroshenko becomes, the stronger he needs or believes he needs some Trump card in identity politics to counter that.
You know, the fact remains that whatever the sources of dissatisfaction, the population takes it out on those who are in authority.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And so,
yeah. So even if they're not dissatisfied specifically, you're right, I mean, I wasn't implying, and you know, but I mean, I think you can kind of see the potential explosive mix there, right? You have people who are dissatisfied a lot, right, with what the current government is doing, right? And it is kind of natural, you know, just as they were saying, that everything that stands for the government is rejected, right? So it's not just like, okay, I'm going to pick like I like this and I don't like that. It's like they are all terrible, right? I'm not saying this is going to necessarily have consequences, right? But I'm saying this is something to be aware of, right? That this is not like that such a clear cut that if the poll is not specifically about language policy, therefore, you know, everybody's...
I think we saw that in 2010.
Yeah.
I mean, Yanukovych was overthrown because he worn out his welcome, and then
mm-hmm.
an incident occurred that led to polarization.
Exactly.
And
just something to be aware of. I'm
yeah.
not like... More
okay, I think what I would like to do is just thank the panel. These were really fascinating presentations, a good conversation. So let's show our appreciation. That's what Toby will say. Final words.
Final words.
Well, you wouldn't believe it, but we are really very close to the end of our conference. And when we started it, the idea was to look at our past, appreciate it, and look into our present and think about future. And I think we managed to do all of that. The last 2 days showed that we are really, as the founders of this place, and I mean the Ukrainian Research Institute and Program, as the founders envisioned, are engaged, are integral part of the academic world here in this country and in the world as a whole. And we are very much also engaged and are part of what is going on in Ukraine. So I think we achieve our goal. With your permission, I declare the conference to be a success. And I want to say that we were helped in that success with powers probably stronger than us, because almost every speaker and every panel was behind the schedule. Nevertheless, we managed to make breaks for coffee. We were all fed and had lunch, and we finished in 2 days. So I don't know how we accomplished that, but one thing I certainly want to thank the chairs of the panels. They were an important part of that. I want to thank all the participants, guests. You made this conference what eventually it became. And I specifically want to thank people who contributed more than others, and certainly probably much more than I did, into preparing this conference and making it what it became. And these are two of my co-chairs, Timish Holovinsky and Lubomir Haida. Tamara Neri, who all you know, and again, travel and venues and other things related to the conference. This is certainly her contribution to the conference. Christina Conroy, preparation exhibition with the help of others, but also media contact. Scott, financial part of the arrangement, extremely important. For those of you who didn't get that yet, you will have a chance to appreciate that. Konstantin Bondarenko, IT, Michelle Vize, Alla Karasova, Oleg Kotsuba, Helena Hrin, you certainly saw them at the book table, but also they participated in other things, and then our wonderful students, Sarah, Alejandra, and Megan. So that I'm pretty sure, I'm absolutely sure that I missed somebody. I thank everyone who participated in this conference. With regard to the publications, we consider the publication of articles not as one volume, but as parts of the Harvard Ukrainian studies, and you will hear from us in the future. So with that, I want to say you to say thank you and say see you in 50 years. Thanks.